To you are, I love you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Lord, we love you and we praise you, and today we just declare great and beyond measure is your faithfulness.
Yes, Lord.
God, we thank you that your mercies are new every day.
Yeah, hallelujah.
Every day, God. And Lord, we declare today that you are our portion, you are our inheritance. And God, because of that, we have hope in you.
Yes, Lord.
And God, today we wait expectantly for you to move and for you to love on your kids today. Lord, you are good. God, you're good to those who wait confidently for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
God, for those who seek you, based on the authority of your word, God, you are good.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
We declare today that salvation is from you.
Amen.
We declare today that healing is from you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
God, we declare today that peace in our minds come from you. That rest comes from you.
Hallelujah.
That our joy, true joy, comes from you.
Hallelujah.
Lord, I pray today that you would bless your kids. God, as we have blessed you, that's our desire, to bless you and to lift our voices and lift our praise.
Jesus.
So that you know that we love you, God. We're obedient to your word today. And so, Lord, for those in this room that need healing, we pray that you would touch their bodies now.
Thank you.
That you would bring strength to those areas that are weak. God, that you would bring comfort to those areas that are experiencing pain right now. We command pain to go in Jesus' name. We pray for strength now to come. God, we pray for different ones that have had surgery this week, God, and last week, recently. Lord, that you would continue to heal.
Yes, Lord.
For full recoveries in bodies.
Yes, Lord.
God, we pray that today, as we examine your word and share your word, that peace would fill each heart. God, maybe there's some here in the room today that maybe haven't made a commitment yet to live for you and to surrender their lives to you. I pray that even by the end of this service today, that you would speak to them and that you would reveal your unconditional love to them.
Yes, Lord.
They're going to be like, Lord, we want to give you a shot.
Yeah, Lord.
Hallelujah.
God, it's so cool that we can come together as one body in unity, lifting up your name, exalting you in your goodness. Jesus, you are amazing.
Yes.
We just thank you that as you went on that cross, God, you took all our pain, you took all our misery, you took all of our sin, and you were that perfect sacrifice for us. Thank you for that. And we just celebrate you that you are alive and well, the right hand of the Father. Holy Spirit, we honor you today, and we know that you're here in this place. Continue to have your way in this service. So, Lord, let our minds now be open to comprehend the words that are spoken.
Yes, Lord.
And God, let it not just stay in our heads, but let it sink down into our hearts. God, we take a moment just to say thank you for your blessings and your provision
this
week.
Thank you, Jesus. Faithful God.
God, we just give you praise for your testimony of goodness.
Thank you, Lord.
Of provision, of blessing. And so, Lord, when you look down upon this family here, God, may it bring a smile to your face. God, may you be pleased with our praise today. So, Lord, we pray for Pastor Lan as he comes and shares with us the truths of your word. Speak mightily through him. God, if there's, you know, just there's things that come up, let him just hear those things that you want to say.
And thank you, Jesus.
God, we just honor you again today. We love you, Lord. Bless our offering and your tithe, our offerings as we present those to you, and continue just to be Lord of everything in our lives.
Thank you, Lord.
We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Why don't you look at your neighbor, smile real big at him, and say, I'm so glad you're sitting by me today.
I'm so glad you're sitting by me.
Good to see you. Well, I'm really pagan today. I don't know what the story is. Good to see you. Praise the Lord. Bright and smiling faces. Some back from vacation or trips out of town or whatever. My wife's sister and her hubby are here today, Roger and Sandy, and we're glad to have them. Amen. Just answer quickly the question about the cast on her right arm. Comes a time when someone doesn't need to experiment on a Segway. Let's just leave it there. Nothing against you, Sandy. One day I'll try it myself, but it's okay. Yeah. I've always wanted to try one of those, but now I'm not so sure. Amen. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for giving. A good piece of change has been collected for our overhead and all that kind of stuff, switching things around, so it's not all in gear yet, but it will be shortly. Thank you for your faithfulness and your special gifts towards that. I really do appreciate it. This is Mission Sunday, so we remember our missionaries. If you haven't taken a chance yet, look at the pictures on the wall there of our missionaries, many of them whom we support. I also support a ministry that's been going strong in Israel for 30 years, and that picture's not up there, however, but just know that your finances are used with wisdom and with grace in the house of faith, and we just appreciate your faithfulness in the tithe and the offering. God is good, He always is, and His mercy endures forever. Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
So would you the ushers come forward now, please, and we're going to receive the tithe and offering. Get me out here, babies. My birthday girl. She's as lovely as when I first saw her. She was 17 and my heart went thump. And I did not recognize why my heart was thumping so much. I was so naive. I just kept telling you stories you wouldn't believe. But she set my world afire, and I didn't know why. Okay, that's enough.
Still is on fire.
Yes, it is. Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. God, thank you for your gifts.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for a good wife. Thank you for a good church to serve. Thank you for a good city in which to serve. Thank you for our people as we gather together as a family of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for the culture of grace, the culture as that we celebrate here in this church of respect and hope. Thank you, God, for planting in us your very life. God, we give you praise for that. Thank you, God, that you meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we're a missions giving and a missions sending church, that our hearts are tied with your heart, our hearts beat with your design and your desire. And Lord, now we're faithful with your tithe and our offerings to your work. We pray, O Lord, that you will bless and stretch the finances and do the work through this house that you desire in our town.
Amen.
As we reach, O Lord, into the schools, into our community, the various things that we do to help and assist. Even for those who come and use our showers on a weekly basis, God, those wonderful people that have nowhere else to shower and they come here. Thank you for those who wash the towels and clean the bathrooms. Make things right, Lord, for people who have needs in our community. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to do that and more. We bless now, O God, your name. Bless your people.
Hallelujah.
We bless the opportunity, O Lord, to be servants of the Most High. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Made a way for us even before we knew a way needed to be met. Aren't you glad?
Yes.
Aren't
you
glad? You're special to him.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, instrumentalists and vocalists on the platform, for helping us worship and praise this morning. Pleasure to have these precious people who serve and practice and really minister greatly in the house of faith. Thank you. For all the staff, everybody that operates in the house in various areas. Thanks for our children's church area, ministry even now, our nursery people. Thank God for all of them. Amen. Intentional anointing is what I want to speak with you about today, and intentional anointing. This year, we're doing things intentionally, on purpose, not on accident. But we are doing things on purpose, worshiping, praising the Lord. In this point, this morning, intentional anointing, just want you to think back with me, please. It had been a long and wonder-filled 3.5 years with a miracle-working Jesus of Nazareth for the apostles and the disciples. Their ages ranged from their late teens and the 20s and on upwards to some elderly folk too. They had witnessed the powerful actions of Jesus and had been exposed to such new teachings like they had never heard before. They heard old scriptures come alive with a revelation knowledge, and they were stirred deeply to the depths of their souls. They were convinced he was the Messiah, finally sent by God Almighty. Blind eyes were opened, deaf ears unstopped, the lame were healed and walked again. The dead were raised to live again. They had seen so many miraculous things. Their hearts were enthused. They believed, and they believed strongly that this was it. It finally had arrived, the redemption of Israel. For example, there were things that happened. The exact temple tax coin needed was found in the mouth of a freshly caught fish. Boy, what a miracle. The fish picked up the right coin and got caught at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
You say, well, it was a coincidence. No, Jesus knew where that fish was, and he was carrying around that stupid coin in his mouth until he got picked up for dinner, and they paid the temple tax with it. 5,000 hungry men, their wives and children, were fed by 5 loaves and 2 fish one time. And on another occasion, 4,000 men, besides women and children, were fed with 7 loaves at another time and a few fish. Was there any need that this man could not meet? It just seemed like everything that he faced, Jesus had an answer. To the smartest critic, Jesus had an answer that turned the critic off. You know, give people enough rope to hang themselves, and that's exactly what Jesus would do. When the fiercest contenders rose against him, he simply spoke a word, and they were put down by truth. Not by a smart-aleck response, but simply by truth. Yet their hearts were stopped cold with fear when one night in the Garden of Gethsemane, after a long day, the Last Supper had taken place, they were fast asleep, deep in sleep, when they were rudely awakened by an angry crowd led by one of their own co-workers in ministry, Judas. Have you ever been awoken from a deep sleep? At first you didn't even know what was going on. A couple times now, our son, who lives, was it 3 or 4 hours away now in Pennsylvania, 3 hours, got up early in the morning and hurrying about his things, did a pocket call to us. 3:30 in the morning, you jump out of bed, you don't know which way is up, run into walls, get the phone, and you hear him wrestling about doing what he needs to do for the day, and I'm whistling, hollering, LJ, answer the phone. No, of course not, so. You know what it's like to be rudely awakened. Here these were, Jesus had asked them to pray, and they just, because of exhaustion, fell deep into sleep, rudely awakened. What? Wait a minute, what happened? Then they remember that Jesus had asked them to pray, but exhaustion had swept past the resolved, and to remain awake, and now confusion ruled the moment. Fear made them quake, and yet Peter grabs his sword and trying to cut the head off the servant of the high priest, he misses and cuts only the fellow's ear. Well, that's a close shave any way you look at it. The disciples run for their lives, and I wonder if any of them hung around to watch Jesus pick up that ear and heal the man's ear to his head again. What do we do now? Seems to be the topic of those now gone into hiding. In a short while, Peter will report back to the group that he managed to get into the courtyard of the high priest, and there he witnessed some of the questioning of Jesus before too much attention was being drawn to Peter. And as it focused on him as a suspected follower of Jesus, he begins to deny that he ever knew Christ. This is the man who just a little while before had said, I'll go to the death with you, Jesus. Don't worry, I got a sword here. Jesus said, put away your sword. That's not the answer. And so, even as they begin to recognize him, he curses and runs out of the place and weeps bitterly. And he hears the rooster crowing in the background, just like Jesus said it would happen. Who all reported back to the disciples? The apostles, we don't know, but the reports begin to accumulate of the 6 illegal trials held throughout the night and early morning against Jesus. The final outcome of the crucifixion, of his death and burial of Jesus. We don't know if the disciples, only John was there, of course, John the Beloved, but we don't know if any of the other disciples were near enough to watch what happened and experience that, but however it was, the reports began to come in. And there was a great deep sadness in their hearts. What sorrow filled them, even as questions began to attack their faith. You ever had your faith attacked? Did you ever come up against something when your faith began to quake and shake and you're going, what is this? Do I believe? Do I still believe? Can I believe? Can I afford to stand in faith? When your faith is attacked, what do you do? Have they wasted their years? Were they wrong about Jesus? What if he was a fraud? What if there really was no hope? What if they had invested 3.5 years into nothing? What if those years were wasted, gone, and would never be reclaimed? What if, what if, what if, what if? There's a lot of doubt in their hearts and lives. What if they'd be captured, tortured, or killed? What if they had to die for what would turn out to be perhaps an empty faith? What if? What if? What was it that turned their gloom into joy? What caused their hope to be restored? What was it? What would alter history forever? Friends, I'm trying to build a case for you this morning that it was not their memory of Jesus, but it was the appearance of Jesus, the risen Lord, before them that began to change their lives. I don't know if you've ever believed so much in something that you invested your life in it. You put everything into it that you had available. You were there. You were involved. You were invested. And all of a sudden, it began to come to naught. Did you have your faith so shaken that you didn't know which end was up? I'm sure we've all had those kind of moments in our lives. Is it worth it? Have I wasted my time? And what changed the disciples was the appearance of the risen Lord. He wasn't an apparition. He wasn't a ghost. He wasn't some sort of appearance of a mystical something or other. He was physically there with them. He was the dead man, formerly dead man, who would never die again. They said, "Are you a ghost?" He said, "No. Ghost doesn't have flesh and bones as I have. Touch me and see that I'm real." To Doubting Thomas, in another meeting, he says, Put your hands in the prints of the nails of my hands, in my side. Touch me and see. Do you have anything to eat?" They said, "A piece of honeycomb and a piece of bread." And he picked it up and he ate it. He said, "Would a ghost be able to eat that?" No. They were convinced that this one who was taken away from them so rudely in such a horrible manner was alive again. And the truth of the resurrection began to alter the course of the history of the world. Friends, I'm telling you not a fairy tale, but the truth. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. And because of that, precious friend, because of that, not the memory of the Lord, but the Lord himself. Let me read a scripture to you in Acts chapter 1, verse 1 through 3. Luke writes this, and he says, "The former account I made, O Theophilus," this is an early man in the church that he wrote to, "of all the things that Jesus both began to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandment to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom," watch this, "to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs." These were not tricks. They could not be pulled on them, no sleight of hand, no questionable movements, but by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days after his resurrection. 40 days. A month and 10 days. 40 days. And speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, do you suppose the risen Lord had their rapt attention? Do you suppose all of a sudden that when the risen Lord came in the room that was locked and closed, they all riveted their attention upon him? Do you suppose they couldn't? They said, "I gotta go to the bathroom, but I don't want to miss anything." pardon me for being so graphic, but do you think for a moment they were able to break away from the contact with the risen Lord? Never happened before. Never occurred in all of history. It was something that was touching them that very moment. Faith was being generated deep in their soul that would not fail them. Many of them later would become martyrs of the faith. They would die because of preaching the truth of the gospel, many of them. And yet to the very end, they would not deny him. They would not back off their faith. They would not leave the Jesus who had revealed himself to them. They knew that they knew that they knew he was real and alive. 40 days. And I'm sure in their hearts they thought, boy, we got this licked. All we have to do is introduce him to a friend and they'll go, oh, I knew he was dead. Oh my God, he's alive. And Jesus came to that point and said, guys, I've got to leave. What? You can't leave us? The proof is undeniable. There you are. Who could doubt that for a moment? Mm-hmm. He said, guys, I've got to go. I got to go. For 40 days, he instructs them. For 40 days, he plants within their hearts the things he said before, but he brings them to memory, and he speaks it in such a way that now there's undeniable proof it's true. And truth is being driven deep within their hearts. An unchanging truth. There is a God who loves us and gave himself for us and would never leave us or forsake us. And yet at this moment he says, I gotta go. And if I don't go, the Holy Spirit will not come. But I'm gonna tell you something's gonna help you out. He said, these 40 days I've been teaching you and speaking with you. Now would you look at verse 4? Acts 1, verse 4. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. Now, friend, I want you to know that when someone makes a promise, it depends on who that person is. If a shady salesman makes you a promise, get it in writing. Everybody said? Yeah. Yeah, boy, I'll tell you how to, right now. But the promise of the Heavenly Father, if the Heavenly Father could raise Jesus from the dead, what can he not do? What could get away from him? The promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. I've taught you about it. Verse 5, for John truly baptized with water, but listen, hang on, guys, here's a new experience totally and completely. But you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. What did that mean? Didn't know. All they knew is that Jesus said, go back to Jerusalem and wait. 10 more days before the Feast of Pentecost. 10 more days before that feast would happen. And on that day, Holy Spirit would be poured out upon them, they would be baptized in the Holy Spirit. What it involved? Don't know at that time. What would happen? Don't know at that time. Why would it happen? Don't exactly know. But Jesus said, go and wait, so that's what we better do. And here's what puzzles me. One of the books of the Bible says, one of the apostles wrote, he said, over 500 brethren saw him at one time. 500 men, the only count of the men, women were there to boot. So out of that 500 that saw him, only 120 showed up. Jesus could throw a party and not everybody would be there. Come on. You follow? You could have a banquet set, not everybody would be there. I'm going to do this, I got to do that, I got to catch up on, you know, cereal, watching my favorite show on DVR, or I don't know, whatever the deal is. I just can't be there. 120 out of 500. Imagine the day later when they talk to the rest of the 380 and they go, "You missed it. It was an anointed service." Think with me, please. He said, "For you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." Verse 6, "Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord," see, they still have it kind of backwards. "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" Mm-hmm. Their mind is still on their interpretation of why Jesus came. Mm-hmm. Have you ever had a thought of why Jesus was blessing you, or why the Lord was leading you, or why this and that was happening in your life? Did you ever have that and you thought you knew the reason for it, and just a little bit down the road the Lord said, "Well, the real reason is this," and he begins to show you something powerful and more mightier rather than you've ever even considered. "Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" Verse 7, "And he said to him," guys, "it's not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority." Now you can read the seasons, you can think about things. You don't have to unscrew your head as a Christian. Keep your head screwed tightly to your shoulders. You can think, you can ask questions, it's okay. God's not offended. But he says this, "But you shall receive power." Jesus gets from the spurious question they're asking back to the most important thing. "You shall receive power." Now, why is that? Because Peter, the bold, impetuous apostle, the one who always jumped out in the middle of everything, the one who jumped out of the boat and walked on water because Jesus said, or he had said to Jesus, "If that you bid me come." Impetuous Peter jumped out and walked on the water, and all of a sudden he said, "I'm walking on water." And he began to sink, because his faith began to waver. Impetuous Peter, when the Lord said, "I'm going to go to Jerusalem, be taken by evil men, and they're going to kill me, I'm going to die, but don't worry, in the third day I'm going to rise again." Peter goes, "Oh, don't talk like that. We're not going to let anyone hurt you, Jesus." And Jesus, I'm sure, raised an eyebrow and said, "I rebuke you, get behind me, Satan. I've got a plan of the Father to take through to the very end. Don't get in my way, Peter." Impetuous Peter, interrupting everybody. Even on the Mount of Transfiguration, Peter, James, and John standing there, Jesus talking with Moses and Elijah. If Jesus is talking to Moses and Elijah, and the word of God is going forth, who in their right mind would interrupt such a meeting? Give me a break. Peter says, "Oh, wait a minute. By the way, let's build three little booths, one for each of you, and we'll have a grand party." And the Lord just rebukes him. "Be quiet, please. We're having a conversation here." Impetuous Peter, "I got a sword." Impetuous Peter jumps out, slashes at the guy's head, knocks his ear off his head. Impetuous Peter, always first to the battle, was one of the first to deny even knowing Jesus. Impetuous Peter did so many things wrong. He now has to take a back seat to revelation of truth. Watch this. He said to them, "It's not for you to know this, but you shall receive power." See, Peter proved what he could do when he was running under his own steam. Some of the other apostles proved what they could do. They ran and hid. Many of the others gave up and turned away. Friends, let me just tell you right now, the old you is under the blood. The old you is passed away. Behold, all things have become new. The old you is no longer present to interfere with the plans of God. "You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be what? Because of this power, you shall be what? Witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the end of the earth." intentional anointing. God doesn't want you and me running under our own steam. He doesn't want us running under our own anointing. He wants us as vessels ready for a new anointing. A new day of effectiveness. A new hour of purposeful living. Intentional anointing. Do you recognize and know that you have divine appointments that no one else has? Would you hear me, please? You have appointments set by God Himself with people that no one else has that appointment except you.
True. Amen.
No one except you. And that appointment must be kept. And how are you going to keep it? You're going to keep it under the anointing of God. Intentional anointing of heaven to accomplish the greater things. Not of your design or mine, but of the design of heaven. Intentional anointing. Acts chapter 1, verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem after Jesus had been taken up from them in the clouds. After he had left, and now they were being obedient by going back to Jerusalem. From the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, the Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room. Yes, that was a call from heaven. Are you ready? It'll be that quick, friends. It'll be that sudden. It'll be that startling. We're out of here. Thank you for that illustration. I appreciate that. Went up to the upper room. And these are the people, some of the people that were staying there. Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot. Judas, the son of James. It's not the same Judas, by the way. Judas, the son of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. Do you know what was happening? His brothers did not believe in him until after the resurrection. James, his brother, would become the leader of the church in Jerusalem. Hello? Mm-hmm. Listen, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there. Look at chapter 2, verse number 1. They were there waiting. They waited in prayer. They waited in supplication. They waited expectantly. They didn't know what was going to happen. They had nothing. They had no grid to base this on. Only that Jesus said, go, wait for the power to come. And watch what occurred. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, you heard that clanking? Suddenly. Suddenly. I said suddenly. There came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, including the mother of Jesus. Give me a break, guys. She got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Maybe you've never thought of Mary like that. She's baptized in the Spirit. And one sat upon each of them. They're all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. As the Holy Spirit came upon them, they were infused with grace, and this power began to flow to be his witnesses. And it filled them so much that languages began to pour from them. And they were so exuberant, the sound was so mighty that people all over the city began to come around that area. It was so wonderful. They came out of that upper room and they flowed down into the streets and they began to just praise and worship God with what he was speaking in their hearts. And as they did, people from foreign lands, Jews who had come to the city for the very, very time of the Feast of Pentecost, maybe some of them had been there. And it had said, crucify him, crucify him. I don't know that for a fact, but perhaps there were. And of all this crowd, they begin to hear these Galileans By their dress, by their mannerisms, they knew where they were from. And yet they were speaking in these languages all over the place, and these people heard them in their own tongue. And they understood the glory and the presence of God.
Hallelujah.
They understood the glory and the presence of God. And here's what occurred in verse 14. Listen, Peter the impetuous, Peter the one who would even take upon himself the ability to interrupt God speaking, now speaks for God. Why? Because the old Peter had been changed. He didn't allow his past to determine his present nor his future. And some of us sat in this room today, and I don't know what all of our pasts were, but some of us had some pasts that we wouldn't want published anywhere. And God, would you listen, please, carefully? God has put your past and my past behind us, and he has declared, don't let that pass. Now determine your present.
Hallelujah.
Nor your future.
Amen.
That's why salvation is so complete and so marvelous and so wonderful. Not only does he take care to save us for heaven, but he takes care of the guilt that's in our hearts because he forgives us. He takes care of the shame in our hearts, whatever we were involved with. He causes us to rise above the guilt and the shame and to rise as a new individual.
Amen.
Do you suppose for a second that Peter hesitated as the Spirit of the Lord said, get up and preach? That Peter goes, I don't want to interrupt you again, God. I don't want to jump out with my sword. I don't want to be impetuous Peter anymore. I don't want to be like I used to be. And God's going, I've changed you, buddy. You're full, instead of being full of yourself, you're full of my spirit. Get out there and do something different like you've never done before. Speak my word. Proclaim the victory. And watch what happens.
Hallelujah.
Boldly now, not allowing his past to determine his present or his future. Friends, Peter rises, and the scripture says clearly, but Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judah and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and heed my words, because the people have said, well, these are a bunch of drunk guys. And he says, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. He said, the bars are not open yet. They've had no opportunity. If they even had the inclination, they have no opportunity to get a hold of alcohol. They're not drunk. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And listen, he preaches from the Old Testament, the only scripture he had at that time. And it shall come to pass in the last day, says God, I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. Mm-hmm. My spirit. Church, awaken to recognition. This is a new day and a new thing that God is doing and has done.
Hallelujah.
And intends the same for us, to walk in power and authority of the Holy Spirit of the Word of God. Oh, look at this. Your sons, he says, Joel prophesied this hundreds and hundreds of years before. Your sons and your daughters, ladies, you're not left out. Ladies, you're not left out. You something, ladies. Oh, you're something. You guys too. But listen to this. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. You'll speak the word of God. You'll speak under the unction of Holy Spirit. You'll speak with authority. You'll speak with power. You are witnesses of the mighty resurrection of Jesus. Your young men shall see visions. God bless the young men seeing visions, having all the hope in the world stuffed deep within them, exploding out the corners, these young people, believing they can change the world, and if you don't stop them, they will.
Amen.
If you don't stop them, they will change the world. They will. They will.
Amen.
Stories told of a young missionary lady, and Lillian Trasher, in the early 1900s, she was engaged to be married, and she felt the call of God in her heart, and she said, I'm gonna go into missions. And she talked with her beloved about it, and he says, I can't do that. I'm established here. We can't go to the missions field. And she took her ring off, gave it to him, and she said, well, darling, I love you, but I've got to follow the leading of the Lord. Early 1900s, was baptized with the Holy Spirit, was praying, and the new, brand new Assemblies of God had just been formed, 1914, and she wrote a letter requesting permission to go to the mission field in Egypt. And she had no stamp. I think stamps were about a penny or two pennies in those days. And she said, God, I don't even have a stamp. And she was walking around the kitchen, and she was praying, and she looked on the floor, and there was a two-penny stamp. Picked it up, moistened it, put it on the envelope, sent it, was accepted, went to Egypt. She arrived in Egypt after weeks at sea on the big boat. She didn't know what to do or how to do it, so she secured a little home in a neighborhood. She learned the language, and as she was there, she said, God, what do I do? I have a couple ladies I've talked to, but what do I do? And she was walking down by the river one day, and birth control was very simple. If you had a baby you didn't want, you threw him to the crocodiles. You fed the crocodiles, kept them happy, and you didn't have another mouth to feed. Simple birth control in ancient Egypt. And you know what? She heard a cry. There was a small baby caught in the bushes, just like Moses was. Wasn't in a little boat, just caught in the bushes. Alligator hadn't got him yet. She picked him up, took him home, began to wash his little body, his diaper. He's maybe 3 days old, little, two or 3 days old. His little umbilical cord still dried. The diaper was sewn into his skin, hadn't been changed since he was born. She clipped him, cleaned him, ministered to him, got healed. People saw her concern, so instead of throwing the babies to the crocs, they began to bring him to Lillian. She established, as it grew over the years and years, she died in the 60s, I think it was, but she established a Lillian Trasher Aswa, I cannot actually say that name correctly. But it was an orphanage that became so great and mighty. Many of the children went through there, have places throughout the government today in Egypt, and have affected Egypt forever. I know they got a lot of problems and so forth, but there are many Christians in Egypt because of one lady's obedience.
Jesus.
Don't tell me you don't have an assignment. Don't tell me you can't change the world. Don't tell me you're unimportant. Don't you dare tell me that you cannot do what God's called you to do. Don't you even speak it. I'm likely to get a real fire in my eye and look you right on and say, what? What are you talking about? Get on with what God has said. Nothing can oppose you, my friend. Precious, precious friend. Hear the word of the Lord. God has a plan for you, and he wants to exercise it through you. I don't know what your plan is. I can't even begin to imagine what your plan is. I wouldn't have the slightest idea how to get you going if I did know. But God does to change.
Hallelujah.
The area around you. Peter stood up. He preaches. The maid servants, the men servants, the young men, the old men. Listen, friends, we're inadequate in our own strength. Peter was. But a great example of failure.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
What a great example of running your own program. But what a great example of God who changes us from the inside out and gives us a new anointing of grace to do what God's called us to do.
Thank you, Lord.
I submit to you today, my friend, that this intentional anointing is for you. By the anointing, Peter overcame his past and he pressed on. And by that same anointing, you can press on. forward for Christ.
Hallelujah.
See, I wish I could change. Well, I do too. But I can't change me. All I can do and all you can do is submit to the Lord who changes us from the inside.
Amen, amen. That's right.
And I just ask you today, first of all, if you've never given your heart and life to the Lord Jesus, boy, is it ever time. This world seems to be going to hell in a handbasket, quite honestly. And I don't even know who to believe anymore, what politician is speaking, whatever, it doesn't matter. It matters only that our God has spoken. Would you listen, please?
Thank you, Jesus.
It only matters that God has spoken to us, not some kind of promise that may or may not come about. He's spoken to us of His grace, His love, and His willingness to change our lives from the inside out. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Maybe you're here today and you've never made that decision for Christ. I must allow this moment for you to make that decision for the Lord. Are you willing? Are you ready? Do you hear the Spirit of the Lord say to you, it's time, child. It's time. Would you give your life to me now? God's speaking to your heart. There's an impetus. There's a thumping of your heart. You know that you know that you know you need Him. And as He's extended that call to you today, would you just indicate that, please, by the raising of your hand and saying, God, have mercy upon me. Would you just do that right now? I just give you a moment. I look across the house. Are you ready to give your heart and life to Jesus? Just a moment. Just a moment. All right. Okay, house is clear, I guess. God spoke into your heart. Have you felt powerless? It's time to be empowered. Baptism of the Holy Spirit is a very wonderful, marvelous, and powerful thing. It's a gift that's given. All we do is ask, and He gives it. Let me tell you what, when the Spirit of the Lord gives it to you, He speaks to your heart in a special way. And as you begin to worship and praise the Lord, there's just something about Him giving you something in your heart of joy unspeakable and full of glory. And then as He gives you whatever that utterance may be, you speak it in faith. You see, it says again, they spoke in faith, in obedience to the Spirit of the Lord who gave them the utterance. They spoke. Holy Spirit never spoke. They spoke in response to Him giving the utterance in their hearts. Precious friend, you need that today. I'm just going to meet with you here in the front. I'm going to dismiss those who need to go. Just 5 minutes after the hour. Thank you so much for being here. But if you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit this morning, I'd just like you, just to, in a moment when I have everyone stand, just come forward, wait for me just a moment. We'll have a few words together. I'll pray for you with some of our people. And you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit, and a new power will descend upon your heart and life. God will be glorified as He gives you power and authority to be His witnesses. Are you ready? All right, can we all stand? I recognize that some of you may have plans or whatever, and I'm going to dismiss those that need to pray. But again, come be with me. I'll pray with you this morning. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad for God who loves and cares? Oh my God, oh my God, how faithful you are. How faithful you are. Church, with a blessing this morning. Church, may the Lord bless you. May He keep you. May His face shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. And may the Holy Spirit of God flow powerfully through each of us to accomplish His purpose and design that He has in our lives for His design in this world. In Jesus' name.